We are talking about function. Gates of hell in society. Gates of hell in society that we're to focus on in our prayer and in our warfare. One has to do with structure. Another one has to do with geographical and demographical grouping. Here's another word I'd like to suggest to you. The word powers or strongholds. Now again, listen. Let me say to you, the next spiritual warfare teacher that you hear or whose book you read are going to use other words than I'm using. Don't get frustrated. Don't blame him or blame me. Simply know what he's using those words to define. I'm using these words because they define to me a particular thing, and I'm explaining that to you. Words are simply symbols to describe an actuality. And so if you use different words, that's okay. You may be describing the same actuality. Now, what do you think of when you hear the word powers or strongholds? Something that's become a power was once weak. Something that's become a stronghold was once, shall we say, a weak hold. So the picture I get here is something that builds up. That gets bigger and bigger, stronger and stronger. More concentrated, more concentrated. Now, since gates are the what? Human will. What is it that the human will can do that mounts up and gets more and more and stronger and stronger? Well, get more specific. Kinds of sin or evil. If I go out this afternoon and sin, would you call it a stronghold? Would you? I go out and sin once, would you call it a stronghold? No. Suppose I continue in that sin for the next 4 years. What would you call it then? Well, you could use many words, but one of the words would be, hey, looks like Dean's got a problem. He has a stronghold in his life. He's been doing this now for 4 years. See what I mean? Trying to illustrate the idea of buildup. I'm the gate. I open myself to sin, and I continually give myself to this sin. I develop a power of. If I go out this afternoon and I steal something, you wouldn't say I have a power of stealing in my life, but suppose I develop, as the one brother said, a habit of stealing over years, what would you call this? A stronghold, a power of, or often we say a spirit of. When does this something become a spirit of something? When you've given yourself sufficiently over to it, now there's a spirit of. So we have powers of lust, powers of greed, powers of materialism, powers of fear, powers of depression, powers of anger, powers of division and strife, powers of lethargy, powers of unbelief. You say, well, how many powers are there? I get sick and tired of people calling everything a spirit of something. I hear people say, oh, I get sick and tired of people calling anything a spirit of this, a spirit of that, a spirit of the other thing. Hey, you tell me how many things people can do wrong, then I'll tell you how many powers there are. Because, see, I don't think the devil has a library of powers, and he takes one off the shelf, flings it at New York City, and all at once everybody in New York City starts to do this. What happens, rather, is that people in New York City, millions of them, give themselves over. It's generation after generation, day after day, concentrated choices, accesses to the enemy of a certain kind, and as a result of them giving themselves to that, there is allowed a power assignment. See how it works? We hear about generational bondages and curses. Some people don't know about this. That's simply that your ancestors gave themselves over to a particular issue. They died, but the power assignment remains. That doesn't mean you will automatically be like that, because there's been some of the people that have come down through your family tree who weren't like that. It simply means the assignment is there, which gives you a greater temptation to or urgency to it. What are you supposed to do? Break them. That's all. You're aware that your family has some kind of a power assignment to it. Break it in the name of Jesus. Don't participate with it. I'm trying to be simple here. Okay, so there are powers over any place that people are sinning. Families, nations, cities, churches, power assignments. I go to a particular church occasionally, the number's about 5,000. Pastor of that church said this is a historic denominational church, one that's been around for centuries, that denomination. He said, when I took this church over, it was notorious in our denomination for killing preachers. Three had left with nervous breakdowns. Three more left the ministry. Hadn't grown, same size for 25 years. Filled with people who hated each other, who didn't even speak to each other, etc. He said, I felt like that after I had an experience in the Holy Spirit, God was leading me to take this church over. Every one of my minister friends said I was crazy. That I went into a time of fasting and prayer. I marched around the empty building. I came against, by name, things that God showed me were power assignments to that place. I broke them in the name of Jesus. From the next Sunday, things were different. Some people left. Some people, new people came. Other people died, but things began to change. As the power assignments were broken, the thing began to grow, began to be moved, and it's a totally renewed parish in the Holy Ghost, sending, training, having the atmosphere of the presence of God, 5,000 people. He traces back the beginning of that to the day he broke the assignments over the church. Now, does that mean the church can have demons? Well, the church is the body of Christ, folks, but the church is also a human institution, isn't it? So wherever people can open themselves through choice to evil and ungodliness, there can be a power assignment if you sufficiently give yourself over to this. There can be a spirit of anything that you can do that's outside of truth and righteousness. So just call it what it is. Don't think of a lot of books are written that just catalog all of the different kinds of spirits. Well, there can be a spirit of anything whatever the nature of the problem is, speak to that. If you're seeing lust, then pray against lust. If you're seeing unbelief, then pray against unbelief. Pray according to what you see, what you discern, what is there. Don't use ambiguous statements, power assignments, having to do with kinds of sin or evil. Now, once you see these things, what you're not to do is just know and talk. Please don't sit around saying, I know the power assignments over your family. Don't go home to your pastor and say, God has shown me the demons over our church. That is really not an intelligent thing to do. All this does is engender controversy and spiritual pride to get us to sit around knowing and talking. Remember the guy told me, God has shown us the prince powers over every nation in our region? Well, see, all he was doing was knowing. He wasn't really doing anything. So what are you to do? Don't just know and talk. Do not. All right? What are you to do? Avoid their influence. Avoid their influence. Number two, pray more specifically. That's why God has shown you, so you can pray more specifically. And number four, live the opposite, which includes intercessory repentance. Live the opposite, which includes intercessory repentance. Now, you come into a situation, all of a sudden you're having funny thoughts, you're having funny feelings, you find yourself getting angry more easily. What's happening here? Is there something deficient in your Christianity? No, God is tipping you off to what's in the area. Why? So you can avoid the influence. I now know what's here, God. Thank you for showing me. Now I can avoid it. I don't have to come under it. It's not inevitable. I'm in Christ, but I've been tipped off. I can avoid the influence. I can be careful. It's like walking across a field in the dark and somebody says, hey, there's been a herd of cattle out there. I'm glad I found that out, because I want to avoid stuff. You have to be from a farm to understand this illustration. But anyway, Once you know what's in the area, you can avoid things. And that's the way you want to live your life in spiritual warfare terms. Once you know what's going on in Vancouver, Burnaby, then you can avoid it. I know this is here. I know there's a real influence of this. I know I'm walking very carefully so I can avoid it. Okay, secondly, we're to pray specifically. Rather than saying, oh God, move and bless, we can say, in the name of Jesus, we break the spirit, the power of this in Jesus' name. And then, of course, in order to build something up that you've torn down, you are now going to live out the opposite. If you're in a place of tremendous oppression and depression, what are you going to do? You're going to rejoice in everything. If you're in a place with tremendous lust, you're going to go to an extreme of purity. If you're in a place with tremendous materialism and control, you're going to be a giver and a server, because this is a spiritual warfare that breaks down the spirit in an area. Again, spiritual warfare is not just a demon rebuke, it's a life lived. Live out the opposite. All right, that includes intercessory repentance. What's intercessory repentance? Intercession means on behalf of another. And it is biblical and important to repent on behalf of others as an intercessory act. Let me give you an example. As a man, I can say to you women, would you forgive us? Speaking on behalf of my group. As an American, I can say, would you non-Americans forgive us? Lord, I repent on behalf of my group for this and this and this. It isn't a repentance that leads to salvation, because only you can repent for your own sin in terms of atonement. But it is a repentance that breaks down the demonic stronghold that's been set up as a result of the sin. You understand? See, I as a white person go to a black person and say, would you forgive us? Now, that isn't because I've actually sinned against him. It isn't that we, either one of us, were alive when the particular thing took place that's evil. But as a result of the hurt and the unconfessed guilt, or the unresolved guilt, there's something still built up in the heavenlies and an enmity between the races. It's a stronghold of demonic power. How do we break that down? We do intercessory repentance. Lord, forgive us, have mercy on us, break down this stronghold between us. And we actually can go to someone and say, would you forgive me? It's an intercessory act that has nothing to do with your sin before God personally. It has to do with breaking down the stronghold and the residue that has existed through the centuries. Sarah, is this clear to everybody? It's part of living out the opposite of what the strongholds are, as an intercessory act to break that thing down. So when you see something in a family, when you see something in a church, when you see something in a nation, live out the opposite so that it breaks it down. If you see tremendous strife and contention, you're never going to cut into that, folks, just by being born again and on your way to heaven. You've got to go out of your way to be a conciliatory type person. Why? Not because you're a weakling, not because you don't have strong opinions, but because you want to do an intercessory act to break down the tremendous strife and contention within a country. And number four has to do with a gate called forces of darkness. Forces of darkness, lie, which is a very small word, but a very big function. This is from 2 Corinthians 4:4, where it says, the God of this world has blinded the minds of those who do not believe. 2 Corinthians 4:4, God of this world, who's that? The devil has blinded minds. Now, this is not territorial. This is not kinds of sin. This is darkness in the head. This is everything from nobody loves you to Hinduism. They're both lies. Is that correct? Come on, some of you have had thoughts. Nobody loves you. That's a lie. It's the forces of darkness spreading that stuff. Inferiority, condemnation come from the forces of darkness. And then it's right up to the religions of the world, which are lies. They're simply complex lies. So complex that we have even Christians that say, well, those people are so sincere and it's so complex, there must be some good in those religions. Folks, there is not some good in those religions. That's not bigotry. That is a recognition of what is happening in the heavenlies. The devil creates complex system of lies for the purpose of keeping men's minds in darkness. You say, well, how do we know? How can we discern what is darkness and what is light? Here it is, folks. Any philosophy or religion that keeps you from the only gospel that can save you eternally is demonic. Any philosophy or religion that keeps you from the only gospel that can save you is demonic. Because again, folks, 10 million years from now, it's not going to matter whether you were right or wrong. It's going to matter whether or not you've been to the cross. And that's the only thing that's going to matter. It's not going to matter that you had compassion on somebody. It's going to matter whether or not you came into line with the blood of the atoning work on the cross. That's the gospel that can save you. How do I know liberal theology is demonic? Because it takes away the importance of the blood of the cross. How do I know Mormonism is demonic? Because it takes away the importance of the blood of the cross. How do I know that Hinduism is demonic? Because it takes away the importance of the blood of the cross. This is the only thing that matters, folks. So I'm not harsh when I refuse any philosophy or religion. I'm not uncompassionate, because compassion means allowing people to come to the blood of the cross, which is the only way you can be saved eternally, because it's the only atonement that was ever made sufficient for sin. And it's serious stuff when you keep somebody from that, even if you say, well, I don't know, those guys are more dedicated than some of the Christians I know. I've never seen Christians bow down 5 times a day in public. I've never seen Christians that can sit in a snowbank for a month with their leg around their neck. These people are really dedicated, boy. I don't know. Must be some truth. And I have a cousin that's a Mormon, and I just think it's really cruel to say that these people are not of God, because they're just so clean cut, they don't even drink coffee. Hey, listen, I want to make you angry at the devil. I got friends and relatives that were Mormons. I was raised all my life till I was 18 in a place that was 85%. Some of my uncles, aunts, and cousins are still Mormons. But I want to show you something here, folks. The Mormon comes to your door, and he's taught to say, we believe everything you believe. We just simply believe that there's a structure into which you have to be baptized. How many of you ever heard a Mormon say, we believe everything you believe? Come on, raise your hand. Now, let me show you how slithery the devil is. You know how much you believe that a Mormon believes? How many of you know that number? This ought to make you angry at how slick the devil is. Here comes this religion, smiling, clean-cut, free enterprise, nice. And he says, we believe everything you believe. And in actual fact, there isn't anything you believed a Mormon believes. Their God used to be a man. Your God was uncreated, never was a man. There Jesus was a brother of Lucifer, was married, populated a planet with his offspring, and came to Utah. Your Jesus didn't do any of this stuff. Their way of getting saved has nothing to do with the blood of the cross. It has something to do with working your way up the ladder by doing good deeds and going door to door and whatever. If you talk to them right, you can get them to admit that they don't really need the Bible. The Book of Mormon is really sufficient. So we got a different God, a different Jesus, a different salvation, a different Bible. Please raise your hand and tell me what is the same. Zero. Now, what am I trying to do? Have a go at Mormons? No. I'm trying to show you the subtle, slippery nature of this liar. So, what is the most compassionate, folks? To be pluralistic and sort of go along with everybody's trip and let them be lost forever? Or stick with the only way your sin can be atoned for and eternal life can come into your being? Well, you tell me what's the most compassionate thing in the long run. And you need to get angry, not at the Mormons and not at the people, but you need to get angry at the forces of darkness that have cooked up philosophies and whatever. What about evolution? Well, you know, there's some evidence that the rocks are 17 billion years old and that this strata says... Look, hey, before we discuss how old the rocks are, I don't even care how old they are. Before we discuss that, let's discuss where God is in all this stuff. Let's discuss where salvation is in all this stuff. Let's discuss what the evolutionary theory tends to do to people's eternal destiny. That's all I want to know about. And there are millions of people who have been damned forever. Did you know Nazism and Marxism came out of evolution? Survival of the fittest and materialist dialectic materialism, that you are only a material being. Isn't that funny? The world's got us all fighting as left and right. Stalin or Hitler, line up. Pick a champion. I'm not really wanting to go behind either one of those dudes, are you? Oh, man. How do you look as a spiritual warrior? You don't look at left wing, right wing, whether or not the fossils are this old. You look at the effect on people's eternal destiny. That's how you must look as a spiritual warrior. And anything that legislates against the only gospel that can save you has got the devil's footprints all over it. Are we clear about this? Okay, I guess so. Now, not only do the forces of darkness lie through philosophies, religions, cults, heresies, religious theories, psychological theories, philosophical theories that legislates against the gospel, but it also hinders the gospel. Hinders the gospel. If you were the devil, and if it's your job to keep men's minds in darkness, what Christian activity would threaten you the most? What? Evangelism. Not prayer, not warfare, not worship and praise, but evangelism. Why? Because, write this down, a large percentage of what we do as a Christian church does not bother the devil at all. A large percentage of what we do as a Christian church does not bother the devil at all. I'm not saying we shouldn't do it. I'm not saying you should shut anything down. I'm simply saying you need to add to it to something that bothers the devil. The devil says, hey, go ahead and have your church activities. Go ahead and be Christians. Go ahead and do all of this stuff and spend your time and your money for all of that. That's fine with me. But if you start reaching in behind the gates of hell to one unconverted person to draw them out of there, you're going to have a fight on your hands, because now you're encroaching in his territory. And that is why, my dear friends, it is demonic to the core that you are not interested in evangelism. Don't come to me after this meeting and say, well, you know, brother, I really am glad you've come talk about spiritual warfare, because I'm really interested in the whole demonic world. But you know what? I have no burden for evangelism. Impossible. You are not interested in getting rid of darkness in the earth unless you are interested in putting light in. Let me say it again. You are not interested in getting rid of darkness in the earth if you're not interested in putting light in. You cannot separate spiritual warfare from evangelism. You cannot separate spiritual warfare from evangelism and missions, folks. Because where's the darkness in the world? It's not lurking behind bushes and trees. It's not out on high mountains somewhere. The darkness in the world is in where? Humans' hearts. Humans' minds. How are you going to get darkness out of the world? Same way you get darkness out of your room. You turn on the light. So if you're serious about removing darkness from the earth, you've got to put light in. Always appropriately, wisely, and lovingly. I'm not saying going out yelling at people. I'm not saying practice certain methods of evangelism in certain wrong attitudes and motives. I'm simply saying be within the realm of wisdom and love. We've got to put light into people's heads. Now, I think we can expand our ability to do that in terms of methodology. I think our methods and our motives have put a lot of people off. of evangelism. But folks, you cannot be interested in spiritual warfare without also being interested in evangelism. They go hand in hand. So, the forces of darkness lie, and the forces of darkness hinder the gospel. That's their job. Now, let me show you how this works in practicality. Let's pray for Afghanistan. See this little dot here? That's Afghanistan. That's our target of prayer. How are we going to pray for Afghanistan? First of all, we pray against rulers. We're going to pray for the president. We're going to pray for the school system. We're going to pray for the family life. We're going to pray for the different structures there. Now we're going to pray geographically. We're going to pray for the north section. We're going to pray for the city of Kabul. We're going to pray for the south part of the city of Kabul. We're going to pray for people groups. We're going to pray for the Kurds, and we're going to pray for the women, and we're going to pray for the children, and we're going to pray for this tribe and that tribe. Now we're going to pray for the strongholds and the powers. We're going to pray against greed. We're going to pray against superstition. We're going to pray against fear. We're going to pray against lust. And we're going to pray against strongholds. Then we're going to pray another angle. We're going to come against the forces of darkness. We're going to come against Islam. We're going to come against communism. We're going to come against philosophies of darkness in their minds. Now, notice we're praying for one Afghanistan. We're coming through various gates. See how it all works in integration? I will build my church, the gates of hell. What is a gate? An access point. What do we do with the gate? We're to shut it in our own lives. We're to rip them open in Jesus' name in society. In order to do that, we've got to know where to focus. And I suggest to you that we focus on structure, on geographical position, on demographical groups, on strongholds of evil and sin in society, and on darkness and in the lives and minds of people. Okay? Well, we're not done with our session. Let's move on here to authority. Now, having seen some of the things the devil is doing, both in our lives and minds, attitudes, mouth, and so on, both what the devil is doing out there in society, what can we do about it? We have to know our authority, and a lot of Christians don't know their authority. They think they do. Let me illustrate this. Suppose I were to say in this Christian gathering here, how many of you believe we have authority over the devil in the name of Jesus? Everybody would raise your hand, and some of you might even clap. This kind of a guru meeting. Amen, we have authority in the name. But suppose I ask the people who raised their hands to go across the passageway out here, because we have a demonic situation in the next room. A number of you who raised your hand and even applauded would say, well, actually, I've been struggling a little lately, and this is not really my calling. Is there a pastor present? Which means what? Which means we know we have authority, but we don't know that we know that we know that we have authority. And the devil has found that out, so he pushes us around regularly, and we're not sure he can't. Or we say, well, I have authority in Burnaby, but I can't pray as far as Coquitlam or Coquitlam. Well, I can pray for my family, but I'm not sure whether I can pray for Afghanistan. And we have all this stuff because we don't really know that we know that we know the scope of our authority. Now, there are wrong concepts in the body of Christ about authority. Take them down. Number one, some of us confuse authority with a feeling. This is particularly true in charismatic and Pentecostal type situations because we have re-ushered in the fact that God has emotions and it's okay for us to have emotions when we serve Him. Nobody's talking about emotionalism, but it's okay to bring emotions into your service for God and your love for God. So we tend then to go to seed on feelings and emotions. And what we do is we say, oh, man, you can feel the authority of God. I come out of a meeting where the presence of God and the power of God and the Word of God has been real, and you tend to go, where's the devil? I feel like I could take on every devil in this state or this city, this province, this area. Only problem with that is 3 days later, you're wondering whether or not you're still a Christian. You've confused authority with a feeling. Number two, we confuse authority with a personality type. Oh, the last speaker we had through here was a tremendous man of authority. Oh, yeah? How do you know? I get really funny answers to how do you know. He was tall. He had a deep, resonant, baritone radio voice. He spoke really fast. He paced up and down. He clenched his fist. He pounded the pulpit. I mean, there's all kinds of answers that I get for what people think authority is. I sit in the back of one meeting with a young man, and he said, you see that guy speaking? You see how he moves into the Spirit and out of the Spirit? I couldn't see it. You see, the problem with this, folks, is if authority is a personality type, some of you are out of luck for life. Because you are really shy, quiet, and retiring. But if authority is a personality type, it has nothing to do with the Holy Ghost in the name of Jesus. If it has something to do with the Holy Ghost in the name of Jesus, everybody in this room can have it, regardless of your personality. Isn't that good news? Number three, we confuse authority with how long we've been a Christian. We oppress each other with this, don't we? And how old are you in the Lord, dear? 3 years. Oh, that's lovely. Myself, I've been in the way now for 47 years, to which we'd like to say, get out of the way. Hey, if authority comes by time, all you got to do to get more of it is watch the clock go around. Did you know that's a basic evangelical tenet, that time makes you mature? How old are you in the Lord? Folks, authority and maturity does not come by time. Otherwise, every time somebody tears a page off the calendar, you're more mature. I don't believe it. The Hebrews had come to need milk and not solid food. They were not new converts. They were third-generation Christians. They had developed to needing milk, not solid food. Immaturity is not just new converts. Those new converts in the book of Acts did fairly well, didn't they? How long had they been Christians? Minutes in some cases. Now, if you've been saved a certain amount of months, days, years, you ought to be mature and often are the most mature, but it's not automatic that it comes by time. Number four, some people confuse authority with what sex you are. Getting dangerous now, isn't it? I was in one place, and the couple that were leading the conference, the wife got up beside me, and she says, you ladies, when Dean's talking about those principalities and powers over nations and stuff like that, don't you try to do that. That's for the men to do. You can come against the enemy where it comes to do with the children and the home and up to 7.5 miles away from the house. She didn't really say that 7.5 miles thing, but I remember thinking while she was talking, I wonder how far away from the home they can rebuke the devil. Folks, if authority has to do with your sex, it has nothing to do with the name of Jesus and the Holy Ghost. If it has something to do with the name of Jesus and the Holy Ghost, the Holy Spirit can fall upon a male, a female, or a donkey. It did all three in the Scripture. Is that right? Number five, some of us think authority is a concept of mind rather than an actual reality. We're very conceptual in Western Christianity. Everything is a theological concept. It doesn't necessarily work in life. And that's why as Western Christians, we've had a hard time transitioning from the church service to the everyday life with our Christianities, because we're very conceptual. Everything's a concept. Oh yeah, I see the concept. Well, it doesn't necessarily get, and we talk in terms of, well, it's in my head, but it's got to get to my heart. See, that's what we mean, is it's conceptual, but it's not practical. And a lot of us know the concept of authority, but we don't live in authority. Now, if authority is not a personality type, not an emotion, not what sex you are, whatever, what is it? Authority is an actual legal reality. An actual legal thing. Let me give you two illustrations about what is an actual and legal thing. Let me give you two illustrations. Marriage and citizenship. Marriage and citizenship. If I ask you in this room today, are you married? What are you going to say? I feel married. I believe. I clean. I've read books. I know the concept. Thoroughly immersed in the idea. See, got nothing to do with it, folks. You're married if you feel it. You're married if you don't feel it. At least that's what my wife tells me. You know why? Because it's an actual legal reality. Say, well, I've only been married today. Does that count? How many of you know it counts? It counts. Because it's actual and legal. Are you a citizen of Canada? I believe in Canada. I feel Canadian. I say, hey. Nope. Won't cut it. You either are or you're not. You could want to be, you could want not to be, but it's a legal reality. You're either a citizen of Canada or you're not. You're not halfway. Say, well, I've been a citizen a month. Does that count? It does. Everybody see this? Are you as much of a citizen in a month as you are in 45 years? Yeah, because it's a legal reality. Now, why do you need to know that? Because the devil is a legal expert. And he knows exactly what you can do, how you can do it, when you can do it, and how far you can do it. But he has found out you don't know. So in order to understand that authority is an actual legal thing and not just a concept, I'm going to use a thing to illustrate it. Everybody watch. See what I have in my hand? I have a bag of markers here. Now, it's not just the concept of a bag of markers, it's an actual bag of markers. Now, we're going to let this thing here, this actual thing, indicate authority on planet Earth. It's not just a concept, it's an actual legal reality here. Now, what happened was when God created human beings in the beginning, he didn't make them like other animals. They are an animal, but they're more than an animal. They're made in the image of God. And one of the things that the image of God is, as he said, I'm going to give you a thing called free will. Now, occasionally I talk to certain theological people and they say, well, actually, the concept of free will is a little difficult for me. Next person who says that to you, pick up a heavy object or a glass of water, like I'm about to do here. Anybody here have trouble with free will? How many of you believe I can throw this water on anybody I want to and the sovereign God will not protect you? Raise your hand if you think he will. We've just all declared our theology. You know that even though God dearly loves you, I am free as a human being to throw this water on you and God will not protect you. Why? Because when he made me in the Garden of Eden, as a human, he gave me freedom. Let me give you one other illustration. It's all you'll need. Child molestation. Do people molest their own children? Is that a fact? You got two options. Either man has free will or God likes this. I think it's option number one. What about you? Does God like children being molested? I doubt it. Then why does it go on? Because God gave free will. Now, wrapped up in that free will, he said, I'm going to give you dominion, authority. And the word here is the word G-I-V-E. How many of you understand the word G-I-V-E? Just in case you don't, I'm going to dramatize it. Everybody watch. Here is an actual legal thing in the universe. I'm God. I've got it all. I make something in my likeness and my image, and I say, I'm going to give you, wrapped up in your free choice, I'm going to give you authority. Everybody watch what happened. Come on, Eve. Something that was in God's hands has now passed over to the hands of man, and it has never been taken back, except in isolated cases like Nebuchadnezzar and Pharaoh. Cyrus. You understand what I'm saying? Now, what I just dramatized for you folks, I believe, is the most important thing you'll ever learn about living on planet Earth outside of salvation through Christ. Why do I say that? Because it's the initial answer to the most asked question in history. What's the most asked question in history? If God's so big, how come? If God's so loving, why does He allow? If God is there, then why doesn't He? I don't know the answers to all the whys, but at least the initial answer is this one. God really did give something away. Now, Lucifer was in the garden. He believes this. You know how we know he believes it? Because he came, not to the other animals, he came to the human beings. Why did he come to the human beings? Because Lucifer has always wanted authority. Isaiah 14 talks about Lucifer saying, I will ascend to the sides of the north. I will put my throne above all the stars. I will be like the Most High God. This was the assertion of Lucifer, the archangel, which is what God had booted out of heaven. Now listen to what he's saying. I will ascend to the sides of the north. The sides of the north is a biblical description of God's throne. Since God is omnipresent, he does not sit on a chair. So the throne of God speaks of what? Authority. So when Lucifer said, I will ascend to the sides of the north, what was he saying? I will take over. I will have authority. He got kicked out of heaven. Now here he is in the Garden of Eden in the form of a serpent, which was not a snake because it talked and it walked. Remember that? I think it was a dinosaur, but we won't go any further on that one. Anyway, here he is in some kind of a beast that's more subtle than all the other cattle. Smart. And it talks. And Eve is not put off by its talking, so evidently that we're used to this. I don't know how this all worked, but anyway, he comes to Adam and Eve, and he said, hey, I saw God give you what I wanted to have in the first place. I want authority. Folks, this is why he's still tempting you and not the animals in the zoo, because you're the one that can give him authority. Does everybody understand this? Because you really have it. So he comes to Adam and Eve, and he said, hey, if you use your free will to disobey God, which you can do, at my suggestion, in so doing, you will give some of your authority to me. Everybody watch. And you know the sad story. They sinned, plunging the whole human race into sin. But in so doing, they gave this to the enemy. What is this? It's actual and regal authority that God gave to man. Not all authority. Notice it goes to here, to here, to here, and to here. God's still sovereign. God's still almighty. He just delegated something. Now man has subleased it to the enemy. What do I mean by subleased? He doesn't have exclusive rights to it. He works through man. If I have an apartment, I rent to this man. He doesn't need it. He rents it to this man. I don't do business with this man except through him. He does business with me through him. God gave this to Adam. Adam gave it to the enemy. Now the enemy's able to work in the earth through people. How much is the devil doing in Vancouver? Let me tell you. I know. He's doing exactly the amount that human beings are allowing him. Human beings both living and dead. Why the dead ones? Because they allowed the enemy. They've died, but he's still here. See that? Because the access point, the gate we learned in the last sessions, is the human will. So the devil is functioning in society exactly to the degree that people, alive and dead, have allowed him. Because that's the access point, because he gave us the authority and we have given it and continue to give it away to the enemy so that he's able to work through us in the earth. Now God came down to this mess and recorded in your Bible in Genesis 3, verse 15. He said to the devil, I'm going to bruise your head. Not directly, but through the seed of the woman. The seed of the woman is the human race. She was the mother of us all. The seed of the woman is the nation of Israel that God chose out of the human race. The seed of the woman is Jesus Christ of Nazareth, who came out of the human race and Israel. Threefold. I'm going to bruise your head. Satan went off in a huff saying, well, we'll see. She had a baby. His name was Cain. He went to work on Cain, influencing him. She had another baby, his name was Abel. Abel was very much like the character of God. Cain was very much like the character of the enemy. So I think he felt That must be the seed of the woman come to bruise my head. He stirs Cain up to kill Abel. Trying to get rid of the seed of the woman that's going to bruise his head. Didn't work. She had Seth, and from Seth came Noah, and from Noah came Abraham, and from Abraham came a nation called Israel. Now, let me sum up the Old Testament in two lines. The Old Testament is the story of God bringing the seed of the woman down through the Israelite nation to bring Christ into the earth. God bringing the seed of the woman down through the Israelite nation to bring Jesus into the earth. The Old Testament is the history of God bringing the seed of the woman down through the Israelite nation to bring Jesus into the earth. And number two, the Old Testament is Satan trying to destroy or corrupt that seed. To destroy or corrupt that seed. That's what's going on in the Old Testament. That's why there's so much fighting in the Old Testament. Every time you turn a page, they encamped against Israel. They went out against Israel. They came down against Israel. They surrounded Jerusalem. Why? There were no seaports. There were no natural resources. Why is everybody fighting Israel? There's no natural reason. There's a spiritual reason. It was Satan trying to get rid of the seed of the woman who's going to bruise his head. Didn't work. Jesus was born. Even after he was born, the devil stirred up Herod to kill all the babies. What's he trying to do? To get rid of the seed of the woman that's going to bruise his head. Jesus grows up in Nazareth. He was tempted in all points like we are. Hebrews 4:15. Yet without sin. As a human now, he is saying no, no, no to sin by his free will in Nazareth for 30 years, saying no, no, no to sin. As a child, as a teenager, as a young single adult, saying no. The sin. Finally, at age 30, he comes to be baptized. A voice comes out of heaven saying, "This guy is the Son of God in whom we are well pleased." He goes into the wilderness to be tempted by Lucifer face to face, and he says no to these temptations, the last of which was, "Bow down and worship me, and I will give you all of the kingdoms." And it was a temptation, folks, because the Lucifer had these, and he said, "Join up with me, Jesus. We got the whole show." No cross, no death, no humiliation, just power. Jesus said no. But it was a temptation. Finally, after 3 years of ministry, Jesus says, "No one takes my life, I choose to lay it down." He prayed in the Garden of Gethsemane, "Not my will, but your will be done." Took him to the cross, hung him there, and they came to break his legs. And it was unnecessary because he had given up his spirit. And he died and went into the place of the dead. Now, does everybody understand why God became a man? Look at this. If God really did give this away to a free-willed being, and that free-willed being was able to give it to the enemy, go ahead. Now, God's got two alternatives, the way I see it. God, of course, is sovereign and almighty, so he might have a million alternatives, but I see two. Number one, he can freeze man's will and turn him into a banana tree or another animal. Or the other option is to become a man himself. Why a man? Because it was to man this was given. So that's exactly what he does. He becomes a man. As a man, he says no, no to sin. For 30 years as a man. As a man, he says, "I do nothing except the Father tell me to do it." He learned obedience by the things that he said no to, suffered. So that as a man, he prays in the Garden of Gethsemane, "Not my will, but your will. Oh, Father, this is a harder cup to drink than I thought it was, but nevertheless, I choose what you want more than what I feel like." So that as a man, he hangs on the cross, says, "No one takes my life, I choose to lay it down." So that as a man, through choice, he was able to take back what Adam had given away. Whew! You ought to be standing on your chair on one leg by now, folks. This is exciting. Okay, speaking of standing, I think we're at the end of another session, aren't we? We are. Let's stand up and thank God for this.